you just love it when it's sweet as candy? Raspberry, strawberry, all those good things. Music and cameo and and candy right here on The Numbers Radio. And I'm Kevin Berry here with you. And, you know, as you grow in life, you learn to appreciate the finer things. And the finer things are just the finest.
The finest.
And here at The Numbers Radio 96.7, we are the finest. The finest in music.
You learn to appreciate the finer things in life. The finest. If I had a choice,
time for me to get out of here. Gotta go, but make sure you keep it locked right here. 96.7 FM, the number, or online at the number spelled with a Z instead of a S. The number is .fm online for sure. I'll be back. Until then, as you go through your day, make sure you do it in a positive way and spread that positivity to everyone you encounter. One love, y'all.
In my day, but just like the wind, they've all blown away. See, to love someone, it's an atmosphere that you both still share when one's not there. There's no real way it can be explained. I guess it's the way I smile when I hear your name. It's the little things you do that mean so much. It's the kiss you look at you, every touch. It's the way I trust you and you trust me. I guess some of us are so lucky. I was known for having the upper hand. I was known as a stone cold ladies man. If it wasn't for you, I'd be that way still. But lately, there's a change in John Lil. Though my friends play games and tease me a lot, I know I'm more than happy with what I've got. When I get up in the morning and go to work, see all day long, I stay alert. Until we come home at night and close the door. Two people share one common core. When I say one love, you can trust me, cause never have I been so lucky.
One love. Just to have just one love, one love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one, one love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one love, one love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one. Just to have just one love.
Now, the love I used to have just left me cold. I used to buy her everything from diamonds to gold. At first, I thought she'd left me cause I didn't buy her enough. But then she left me a note along with all my stuff. Said maybe one of these days you'll have to learn that love is something that you gotta earn. And once you earn it, got to know how to keep it. You got to want it as well as you need it. To have lost love was a hurting lesson. But to have had love was a definite lesson. Now I know what the Beatles was thinking of when they said that money can't buy me love. When you say it all slow, what do you mean? I just went through the exact same thing. Mine was lost for a whole different reason. I lost my love because of cheat. Started roaming through the streets all day and night. I guess greedy best describes such an appetite. I wish I had her back, but it remains a wish. I guess a bird in the hand beats two in the bush. I'd like to thank you, girl, for teaching me love, because all in all, I had a fall. I guess it's better to have loved and to have lost than to never had loved at all.
One love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one love. One love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one. One love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one love. One love, one love. You're lucky just to have just one.
You're listening to The Numbers at KNUMLP Portland and online everywhere at thenumbers.fm.
Hey y'all, this is Ryan Martin from Northeast Portland.
This is BC Okuneye, lead
lead vocalist from ADBC.
What's up, y'all? It's Bria.
Peace, peace, peace. It's your boy Rasheed Jamal the God.
This is Marie.
This is Monique Taylor.
Hey, this is Shay Black.
It's your girl Kayla J.
This is Aminta Abioto. You're listening to The Numbers.
The Numbers.
The Numbers.
The Numbers.
The best station in Portland.
Why do you listen to The Numbers?
I like listening to The Numbers because they play cuts.
I listen to The Numbers because it's the voice of the people. It keeps me connected to my community.
Oh, man, it's simple. Man, it's by the people and for the people.
I listen to The Numbers because it's black music right here in Portland.
Why do you listen to The Numbers?
Man, because they got cuts.
So why do you listen to The Numbers?
Because it's my community.
I listen to The Numbers because it's carrying the culture.
Support for The Numbers comes from Stupid Burger, whose goal is to provide quality and consistent food that tastes great every single time. Home of the signature Stupid Burger, along with po' boys, chicken, vegetarian sandwiches, and more. You can visit Stupid Burger every day from 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Monday through Saturday, and 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. on Sundays at 2329 Northeast Gleason Street in Portland, Oregon, or online at www.pdxstupidburger.com.
X-Ray FM and The Numbers are proud to support Hip Hop Fighting Cancer, a monthly showcase at the Hawthorne Hideaway promoting cancer awareness from Portland hip hop label I Am Jordan LLC. Proceeds from each event go towards supporting the OHSU Unite Cancer Institute. Featuring local Portland artists for each monthly event, you can find more information and the full schedule at xray.fm/events.
DJ Cliff, here's a little something extra for you. The Clip, Lisa Vasquez, and her visit to the Cliff Notes podcast. Because those are the relationships that can turn into pretty amazing things.
Exactly.
Just because you never know who's connected to whom. Not that that's why you're doing it.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, it just when you build those relationships, like you said, it's just you never know where it's going to go, what it's going to lead to. And, you know, keeping it about that versus just very cut and dry about the money. I mean, that's something that turns a lot of people off, you know, in this industry. Like, yeah, be about your money, but don't do it at the expense of integrity and, you know, just being a person.
Yeah, yes, so, no, absolutely. Like, absolutely. You know, so. Yeah, y'all. So you get a chance to check out the full interview with my guest, Lisa Vasquez, on the Cliff Notes podcast. Everywhere you listen to your podcasts and at xraypod.com.
The New York Times side, staying alive was no job at second hands. Moms bounced on old men, so then we moved to Shaolin land. A young youth, you're rocking the go-to. Low goose, only way I begin to G-York was drug loot. And let's start it like this, son, rolling with this one and that one, pulling out gats for fun. But it was just a dream for the team who was a fiend. Started smoking wools at 16 and running up in gates and doing hits for high stakes, making my way on fire skates. No question, I was speed for cracks and weed. The combination made my eyes bleed. No question, I would flow off and try to get the dough off. Sticking up right boys on board. My life got no better. Same damn low sweater. Times is rough and tough like leather. Figured out I went the wrong route. So I got with a sick tight click and went all out. Catching keys from cross seas. Rolling in MPVs every week. We made 40 G's. Yo, brothers, respect mine. I ain't gonna take now. Bam, pull from the gate now.
Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar bill, yo. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar bill, yo.
It's been 22 long, hard years. I'm still struggling. Survival got me bugging, but I'm alive on arrival. I'm deep at the shape of the streets to stay awake to the ways of the world. Deep. A man with a dream, with plans to make cream with fail. I went to jail at the age of 15. A young buck selling drugs and such. Who never had much. Trying to get a clutch on what I could not touch. To court play me, so now I face incarceration. Pacing, no one upstates my destination. Handcuffed in back of a bus, 40 of us. Life as a shorty shouldn't be so rough. But as the world turned, I learned life was hell.
living in the world no different from a cell. Every day I skate from takes, giving takes, selling bass, smoking bones in the staircase. Though I don't know why I told you smoke cess, I guess that's the time when I'm not depressed. But I'm still depressed, and I ask, what's it worth? Ready to give up, so I seek the old earth. Who explain working hard may help you maintain, to learn to overcome the heartaches and pain. We got stick up kids, corrupt cops, and crack rocks and spray shots, all in a block that stays hot. Leave it up to me while I be living proof to kick the truth to the young black youth. The shorties running wild, smoking cess, drinking beer, and ain't trying to hear what I'm kicking in his ear. Neglected for now, but yo, it got to be accepted. The what? The life is hectic.
Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, yo. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, yo. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, yo. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, yo. Yo. Excuse me as I kiss the sky. Swing the phone to six, put the pocket full of rye. On the dime, throw the culture. From the dead body like a vulture. The galleon, blacker than your wagon stallion. Hit your housing, projects I represent your shallon. Hell yes, apocalypse now, the gunpowder be going down, diggy, diggy, down, diggy, down.
While the planets and the stars and the moons collapse, when I raise my trigger finger, all your fuckers hit the deck. Cause ain't no need for that, hustlers and hardcore. Roar to the floor, roar like reservoir doors. The green-eyed bandit can't stand it. With more fruity and loose than that, you can't stand it. Plus, the Baba Z got me wild. Messing with this, it's a straight suicide.
Look up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane.
It's the funk doctor spot, smoking from the train. So how did I get this design? Look up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane.
Breaking out Johnny Blaze, ain't a damn thing changed. Kiss the sky.
Yeah, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2,
murder, one lyric at your door. Take out, bring it to that ass, bro. Breaking all the replay glass, George. You got to get mine to get yours. We don't need no rap tour. I'd rather get the facts and catch you in the rap chore. More than you bargain for. The capital stays open like an all-night store. For real, I keep shit down like a piece of blue steel. Pointed at your tumor with the intent to kill. And in your existence, M.E.D. ain't no use for resistance. H.O.D.
I shift like a clutch with the ruck. Examine my nuts, I don't stop till I get enough. 6 million ways to die, so I chose. Made it 6 million and one with your eyes closed. And blindfold. Cold, so you can feel the rock and shatter the glass in second half where your monkey at. And you're my man, hit me now. Just used to play me, now they can't forget me now. They get me knocked down, they get me knocked down.
96.7 FM, the Numbers Radio. You have DJ Michael Morris putting it in the mix for you. I'm Kevin Berry, and we're going to be here bringing it to you, getting you a little high, because music makes you high.
Yo, Raph, bring me along.
Come along.
I know Spink got my back. Freaky toss, fuck the charm dealer. 1, 2 for my man, pretty new. As I bless the rest of my New York City crew. As we continue to bring you the flame. Representing LB from the cradle to the grave. Now, how's that? One time for your mind. But I write down the line, give sight to the blind. And I'm coming through with my clip. What you gonna do when you get sick? Gonna start your running and hiding. Is you gonna start your slip in the sky? Man, I thought you had this game in this man. I'll do it for real. It's the Mr. Chief saying, freaky cop. Pretty, pretty new friends. Think it's big, nice thing. For the money, 2 for the 9. 3 for my people's in the struggle getting by. 4, 6, 3, nice and freaky time. Mr. Sex sent me off with this drug called a track. Put me in, gave me the sign to react on. Whoever comes in my path. Hey yo, I make you feel the rap, kid. Any volunteers down to lose their careers. We fears, no fears. Legal drug drugs coming through, that's the deal. Beyond 9-5, they'll be fam, keep it real. It's hard as peace, walking on the park streets. On 9-4 peace, and even my wife cheats. So I got to tally up and get it on, get it on. Word is born, I must represent for my fam. To the day that I die, so peace. From the year 9-5 to 2G.
should already know when I walk in the door that it ain't no use in frontin' on me. Frontin' on me. I'ma hustle, I'ma do my thing. You already know what it's gon' be. What it's gon' be. I keep hustling. I keep hustling. I keep hustling. I keep hustling. And if you feel me, put your hands up and come and sing the Hustlers Anthem with me. Anthem like la 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 la. Yeah. Yeah, I keep hustling, dog. I keep hustling, dog. Yeah, yeah, I keep hustling, dog. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, let's go. Let it do what it do all day. Come through and get it jumping, throwing money away. It don't matter if you're hustling a bundle of yay. Or you got a 9 to 5, let the champagne spray. Boom, take a little Dom or Jouer Rosé. 2 chicks on my arm when I step, okay. Gillette razor sharp, you know the boy don't play. DC 10, drop me down at Sandro Pay. Yeah, let the money machine roll on. We've been eating it like you in the street so long. Every time I drop, see I can never do no wrong. I progress you when you the crew prolong. Go. You hate a McDonald's, your forte. We blind your little shine, shine you portray. Why you wanna leave? I know your little chick won't stay. And if you violate, see, I'll make sure you all gon' pay.
You should already know when I walk in the door that it ain't no use in frontin' on me. Frontin' on me. I'ma hustle, I'ma do my thing. You already know what it's gon' be. What it's gon' be. I keep hustling. I keep hustling. I keep hustling. I keep hustling. And if you feel me, put your hands up and come and sing the Hustlers Anthem with me. Yeah, yeah. I keep hustling.
How y'all feel out there?
Yeah, yeah.
Focus, focus, notice, yeah, uh-huh, squad in here.
How y'all feel out there?
Yeah, yeah,
couple of bros,
Yeah.
Hey, yo, what up, E. Sermon?
Just back again with a 1-2 in the baseline that's bound to win, so. It feel good, don't it? Rock the spot, won't it? We're doing this early. Me and my squad, we ball like Melock, Lemon Low, Lips been curly. My peeps came up in here and cab a beat to hear this beat in the club.
Put more bass in this club.
Okay, that's love. And now I rock spots and pump it like drugs from so-called thugs. Me, I'm low-key, laid-back type of fellow. When the spot get hot, I keep it Carmelo. So watch the nugget.
What? Something brand new from E-Dub.
That's bound to bub. But I don't care if I don't get one spin. I give a what? Like Lil Jon and them, yeah.
I made it easy to dance to this.
Second verse,
church.
It's a new sound around, you heard it first. This here make it stomp in Atlanta. Walk in LA, two step to Chicago. Chicken head in St. Louis. In New York, man, we do what we do. Everything brand new. Sy Scott,
what up?
Pull it down while I get my dance on, my B-boy stance on.
Hey, yo, DJ, turn the record up one time. Watch Thugs 1 and 2 step and love slide. My squad landslide like mud slide. Campside, when I move, you move synchronized. Double and Scott don't play. We keep it live all day till it stay jammed inside your playlist all day.
I made it easy to dance to this. I made it easy to dance to this.
They shoot, 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 that's an echo. Not talking about clothes, this come from flows. 40 G's of pop, that come from shows. Constant screaming, that come from hoes. Keep my squad hard as Brillo. Me, Prof Kai Sai, Unique, and Pillow. T-H-O-T.
And the R-E-D.
And Keith Marie, now y'all feel me,
I made it easy to dance to this. I made it easy to dance to this.
DJ
DJ Michael Morris putting it in the mix for you right here on 96.7 FM, The Numbers Radio, where we do it and do it and do it and do it.
We like the breeze, flow straight out of our lids. Them, they got boo bodies, hard rock Brooklyn kids. Us, floor rush, when they DJ booming classics. You lick the crew on the fattest hip-hop record. He touched the kinks and sinks into the sounds. She frequents deep, fatter joints called undergrounds. Our funk zooms like you hit the Mary Jane. They flock to booms, man, boogie had to change. Who freaks the clips with mad enough percussion? Where kinky hair goes to unthought of dimensions. Why is it so fly? Cause hip-hop kept some drama. When butterfly rock the light blue suede boomers. What about a cut? We push it off the corner. How was the buzz the entire hip-hop era? Was fresh in fact since they started saying Audi? Cause funk's made fat from right beneath my hood. The poober of the styles like Miles and like 60s funky worms with waves and perms. Just sending junky rhythms right down the block. We beat so
okay. Good evening, everyone. Welcome. It is so amazing to have you all here tonight to celebrate the opening of Hank Willis Thomas, All Things Being Equal. Yes, woo! So excited. I'm Sarah Krajewski, the curator of modern and contemporary art here at the Portland Art Museum.
I'm Julia Dolan. I'm the minor white curator of photography here at the Portland Art Museum, and we're so happy to have you here. Before we begin this evening, we would like to recognize and honor the indigenous peoples of this region on whose ancestral lands the Portland Art Museum now stands. These include the Multnomah, Kathlamet, and Clackamas bands of Chinook, the Tualatin, Kalapuya, Malala, and many other native communities who made their homes along the Columbia River. We pay respect to their elders, past and present.
The Portland Art Museum relies on private support to fuel our public mission, and more than 60 funders helped to make this exhibition possible. Folks gave at levels big and small, and we are very grateful to all. We would like to thank our major sponsors. We received early support from national foundations, including the Andy Warhol Foundation for the Visual Arts, Henry Luce Foundation, National Endowment for the Arts, Institute of Museum and Library Services, Community Catalyst Initiative, and the Samuel H. Kress Foundation. And our local community of supporters rose to the occasion with major support coming from Zidell Family Foundation and our art museum trustee, Matt French, Spencer Noker and Cambria Benson Noker, William G. Gilmore Foundation and trustee Mary Lee Boakland, Nancy S. McGraw, the James F. and Marion L. Miller Foundation, Meyer Memorial Trust, and Regional Arts and Culture Council Arts and Education Access Fund, the Arts Tax. We're also very grateful to our wonderful host committee who've been helping us get the word out about the exhibition and the opening week's events. And one last quick note that tonight's stage was set by Look Modern and Tufinkian Carpets. So thank you for your attention on all of the details there.
To introduce our participants, please welcome Ella Ray, who is the Portland Art Museum's Kress Interpretive Fellow and Community Partnerships Coordinator. Since January, they have dedicated their time and efforts to the community partnerships surrounding the Hank Willis Thomas All Things Being Equal exhibition. Ella?
Thank you. Hello, thank you for being here, everyone. I wanna say a big thank you to We Black first and foremost for partnering with us on this event. Yeah, shout out to y'all. Thank you so much. And another big thank you to all the people who've been working on the All Things Being Equal exhibition. It takes a lot of people to make this happen. So shout out to you and shout out to all of you for being in the room. Thank you so much. Before we get into the critical conversation, I'd like to introduce the panelists. First, Hank Willis Thomas is a conceptual artist living and working in New York, whose practice primarily focuses on themes relating to perspective, identity, commodity, media, and popular culture. Moderating this evening is D.A. Carter. D.A. Carter teaches, writes, and creates art about Black life. He loves cognac, Gladys Knight's voice, and his crew. He is the author, co-author, or co-editor of multiple books, which will probably be published soon. Representing We Black, which is Wieden and Kennedy's Black affinity group, I should say, Ragen Fykes. Ragen Fykes finds her visual artistry through the textures of wardrobe styling. Her directives come from single motherhood and being a late-blooming lesbian. She's a Cancer Leo cuspy and is also really terrible at introductions. Last but not least, we have Danielle McCoy, an Antiguan-born graphic designer and artist currently based in Portland, Oregon. Her work expresses themes of identity, race, gender, religion, culture, and mental health through words, graphic design, and book-like objects. And lastly, before stepping off the stage, I'd love to announce that immediately following the discussion and the short Q&A that we will have, we will be opening the gallery so y'all can have the first look at the exhibition. Ow. Thank you so much. Let's welcome y'all to the stage.
Why are you still having the bag?
Just a little swallow. Whatever you don't want, I take.
Yeah.
Just a little swallow.
I'ma just smell yours.
Uh-huh. Cool. Ain't got some water, hydrate. Hey y'all, how you doing? Okay. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah? Okay, cool. Thank y'all for coming. It's good to be here. We just gonna post up and chat, talk about some images, and geek out. That cool? Okay. Hank, you wanna say anything before we jump in?
Well, thank you all for coming. It's amazing to see all these people here and just feel really humbled and really grateful to be here with you all. Thank you guys for participating in this. I didn't hear anybody say you're welcome. Thank you all for coming. Oh, thank you. That really means a lot to me. I mean that.
Hank, what sign are you again?
I'm a Pisces.
Pisces. I know some of y'all. All right, so we've got a few images. We're just going to chat it up about the images. Let's go. Okay, so Hank, one of the things as a Black Studies teacher, I'm really fascinated by intimacy and the erotic. And whenever I think about or show my students D'Angelo's Untitled video, I start obsessing over torsos, Black torsos. And so I was wondering if you could talk to us about just putting this piece together with Dennis Rodman, and it's from the Got Milk campaign, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, just can you tell us if intimacy or the erotic played any role in the construction of this image?
Yeah, well, this is a picture I presume was taken by Annie Leibovitz originally for the milk, the Got Milk campaign. Mm-hmm. A lot of what I was always interested in growing up was how media images come together and how they shape our notions of who we are and who other people are. But one of the things that really happened, I think, in the 90s when Dennis Rodman went off script as a basketball player and started to get his body tattooed and dye his hair and kind of embrace kind of aspects of counterculture, is that a lot of things that were once counterculture became the norm. And so I can't look at this image unbranded. So when I did the unbranded project, when I decided that I wanted to look at kind of advertising images undressed, so to speak, this image I could not help but to include this in the series Unbranded Reflections in Black, mm-hmm. by Corporate America from 1968 to 2008, and there's just so much there, mm-hmm. or maybe not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's flesh in flesh in flesh.
What do you see?
Who, me?
Yeah.
Oh man, I'm a lush and a hussy. And so I'm like, there's something that's so charged about it. It's like, yes, the return of the gays, like that's cool, but also it is such a great flex, right? It's like stretching skyward, but also like bending the arms back is like low-key kind of submissive, like that. He could be standing up or he could be laying down. There are all of these things which like to my little spirit, it's like, well, go ahead, Dennis. Do all the things. Stretch, be in your skin, be in your flesh. And it feels so private to me. Mm-hmm. Like, it doesn't feel like it's a part of this campaign. It doesn't feel like it should be on a billboard. I'm just like, might as well be a candidate.
No. But I noticed you didn't mention anything about the lip gloss.
No, not at all. I like the rest. You know, it's a little accent, you know, a little pop of flash.
Uh-huh.
You know, yeah. You ready for the next one? All right, Danielle, Ragen. With this one, can y'all just tell me, you can tell me like based on your professional experience, but I'm really interested in how you all make sense of what's being communicated here. Because this is also from Unbranded, right?
Yeah, so just to give a little context for the project, I took two ads for every year from 1968 to 2008 and removed all the advertising information to look at kind of what's being sold. My previous series was called Branded, where I was making images that looked like advertising. But I realized at some point that truth might be better than fiction, so that rather than making images that are speaking in this really this language, that I could maybe say more by kind of chronicling what happens when you focus on a very specific demographic. And I think this was from 1972, and it was Palmer's Cigarettes. Mm-hmm. And cigarettes and alcohol,
yeah.
Companies were the first to really see the black community as a market.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to give that context.
Yeah, yeah. All those Johnson Publications pieces, right? It's like Ebony and Jet. It's all of these really beautiful, stylish liquor and cigarette ads, right? It's like little me was just looking back in a particular kind of wonder with these older issues of Ebony and Jet, just thinking like that was for me as much a part of the black aesthetic as like anything that Hoyt Fuller and that whole crew in the 60s was coming up with, which is a trip. But I'm wondering, okay, Ragen, Danielle, when you strip down these images and think about, as Hank said, like what's really being sold, what do y'all think gets lost when companies start layering over and over and over these images?
Danielle, you start.
I think, again, as somebody who works in the context of advertising and is one of the people who is responsible for making these images, you know, oftentimes when you, for instance, get a brief or are given lines, there's this kind of putting together and constructing that you have to do to obviously sell the thing the client wants you to sell. And I think what gets lost, or lost in the sense of what gets taken away once you layer all the noise over imagery, is that you, I'm really nervous, y'all. I just want to say that.
I think you too, looking at this photo, I see, it's beautiful. I see my family. I see my heritage. I see a lineage. But sometimes you lose the reality when we layer the advertisement on top of it. Mm-hmm. You lose the reality of what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you lose the reality of where it comes from,
mm-hmm.
and the focus of where it comes from, the heart of where it comes from. For me, that's what I see, and I can look at that across boards of many ads, many, many things that we face in society every day. Sometimes when we're forced to strip down and look at it, we look at the reality and the honesty of what mm-hmm. it actually is,
mm-hmm.
and how it actually sits and impacts us. You know, and being a black woman too, it's just like how it really impacts us and how it lives with me
mm-hmm.
as I navigate life.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a trip to me, like looking at specifically with Unbranded, how when I look at this, I inevitably start thinking about popular culture and how blackness is the grammar for American culture,
mm-hmm.
right? And it's like black folk been saying it since been saying it, right? But it's really interesting to me the kind of mastery, the visual mastery over black bodies that is represented by the layering of narratives onto this particular kind of image of black people. So there's that. Brandon, Hank, can you set the stage for this piece for us?
Sure. I remember making it. Set the stage. I read a book, I think, when I was in graduate school at California College of the Arts, and it was called Michael Jordan and the New Trans Global Economy. And it looked at how many companies in different industries were able to grow their business primarily off of his grace, in a way, and that he, so like it talked about how Nike went from a $10 million company when he signed in 1984 to a $10 billion company when he retired in 2003. And how, you know, whether it be Hanes or Gatorade, the NBA, all became kind of these major trans global corporations through their ability to kind of feed their message through him. Mm-hmm. And I was fascinated with him being a descendant of slave and how transnational corporations were responsible for the slave trade that brought our ancestors here. Mm-hmm. And then also how he became a transracial figure in many ways through his both apoliticization, but also the certain cues that still made him black. And I was really just fascinated with that and started thinking about how slaves were branded as a sign of ownership, and then how we brand ourselves, like we live in a branded society. We're, you know, really just the first generation of people who most of what we do is mediated through a corporate lens. Like the phone that I have in my pocket that I talk, like I, that's a corporate language. And the cars we drive and the clothes we wear really are meant to tell people, give people cues about our own value system. So I wanted to think about that, and I asked my friend Bayate to come to studio with me, and I photographed him, and you know, I don't know, it just kind of grew from there.
The subjects in Branded, are they branded or do they brand themselves? I can never quite
figure. This is Photoshop.
Well, no, but.
People have thought it was real. Sorry, too literal.
Pisces.
Right. This is what I get for drinking brown liquor and trying to immerse myself in the work. I'm like,
too much, I don't know what you have in here.
Right. So, you know, it's like I look at the pieces and now I'm trying to figure out. Because I have these conversations with a lot of folks about talking about black bodies. Like, talking about black bodies is not the same as talking about black life or black people, right? And so when I look at Branded, like, I'm wondering, well, who is the person that does this particular thing to the body, right? Are we supposed to read it as corporate America? Not supposed to. One way to read it is, right, like, corporate America is doing this thing to black people, and the markings on black people's bodies are evidence of this particular kind of abuse. Right. But also, I'm like, what about those moments when black people claim a branding and claim it in a way that in part prevents us from understanding their interior life? Is there room for that read in some of these pieces?
Especially when you're very smart. I think you're going a lot deeper with it, I think, than I sometimes intend. And the best thing about being an artist is you get other people's ideas. You're like, yeah, that's totally what it was about. But you did remind me, though, Michael Jordan has a brand on his body. He's a member of Omega Psi Phi fraternity. And so there's a tradition in many black fraternities of branding your body with the logo of your fraternity. And so that question becomes deeper for me, where because, you know, there's other rituals within that. And then I also think about, there's another piece in the show, Scarred Chest, which is about scarification.
Yep.
And so I think the work is open to interpretation. And I'd love to see you write from the perspective of one of these subjects.
Gotcha. Digga, I got a question for Ragen.
Hey, girl.
Thankfully, I just took a sip.
Come on. Okay. That's what's up. So as much as you can, like, bring us into Wieden and Kennedy. And let us know what conversations, if any, happen about Black bodies in advertising.
And how Black bodies are promoted in advertising?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's a constant question that I feel like being in the space of Wieden and Kennedy, where I think it's something that we always think about. I think I'm lucky to work for a place where those questions can be asked. We can talk about them freely. Mm-hmm. We can say what's uncomfortable about it. We can say where it's wrong. We can say where it's right. And we have people that will, hello, Beyonce. We have people that will go to bat for us in that. Mm-hmm. So I think it's something that is constantly considered. I think, you know, at the end of the day, advertising is advertising. Mm-hmm. And there are certain things that are amiss. There's always work that has to be done. We were speaking yesterday about this situation with a Black designer and a bigger corporation kind of taking advantage of him being this Black designer and picking his brain for his view on being Black and being a person within the fashion industry. And in this article where he's sharing where this person completely took advantage of him, he said, appreciation without empathy is appropriation. And I think that that is something that we're constantly looking at and constantly trying to get to the core. I think Wieden and Kennedy, a lot of us are very aware of how being a Black person, our influence in what we wear, what we do, what we create, how we bring to life, quite frankly, a lot of what we do, a lot of what we take in, a lot of what we appreciate, a lot of the yes and what we say, all of that. I think we're very aware of that. And I think being in the scope of a place where there's people that are gunning to make sure that that is down to the core, down to the client. And if it's not, that they know about it. So, I mean, I feel thankful in that regard, but we're not perfect. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And there's always moments for growth and continual growth.
And I feel like, again, as somebody who has a hand directly in making images, I, as a designer, also set a certain precedence for myself. Like, for instance, using Photoshop. There are certain things, as far as editing for photographs go, that I will not do to a Black body. That's just a personal choice.
Like what?
Like, I mean, there are times when you're doing comps for a particular client, and it would require you to do some Photoshop voodoo to make things look good, and oftentimes you can end up dismembering somebody in Photoshop, and I make a point not to do that, especially when I'm dealing with bodies that look like mine. It's just too layered for me to kind of take that approach when I'm making those images.
I think my daughter has something to say.
Yes.
Hank, can you tell us about this piece?
Well, this piece is called Raise Up, it is based off of a lot of my work come from a photographic background, and my relationship to photography changed when photography changed, when it went from an analog, relatively patient kind of medium to a kind of a medium of immediacy when it became digital. And there were more images that were taken in a single second than any of us could make sense of in our entire lives. And I decided that I wanted to start to look at historical images and advertising images to kind of think about their impact on our understanding of history, but also the present. And so I was doing an exhibition in South Africa in 2014, and I came across an image by a photographer named Ernest Cole, and it was of South African Black miners being strip searched. And you could see their butts, and it was something that I felt when I was looking at the image, I was also gawking, because I was like, their musculature and all of this stuff, and I felt that I was maybe almost kind of creating a certain form of abuse just through my kind of bearing witness to the image. Mm-hmm. So I decided that I wanted to give them some agency, I don't know if it's true, by cropping it at their shoulders. Mm-hmm. And titling it Raise Up. That was in February of 2014. Mm-hmm. Many of you might recall that in July 2014, Michael Brown was murdered by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. Mm-hmm. And when I first got a chance to show this work in the United States, people called it the Hands Up, Don't Shoot piece, because mm-hmm. that was the protest movement of the time. And so, in a way, I was struck by how a piece that I made about something that happened halfway across the world 50 years ago seemed to speak so eloquently to something that was happening in the future. Mm-hmm. This piece is also a larger version of this piece is that's life-size, is up now at the National Memorial for Peace and Justice, which is also called the Lynching Museum.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And their gesture of surrender could also be a form of baptism mm-hmm. and kind of revolt. There's all of these different things that I see in it. Mm-hmm. But it was a very transformational piece for me, because my first time trying to figure out how to look at an element of a photograph as if I could crop it in three-dimensional space.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems increasingly there are, maybe it's recently, a number of writers and artists and activists are paying attention to abstraction, cropping, what Christina Sharp would call like black annotation and redaction, to get us closer to the idea of black life. And so you see this photograph and you recognize or you acknowledge that as a viewer, your particular relationship to this image could be reinscribing a particular form of violence. And so one response to that is to create this work based on a cropped version. Right. And so it's interesting to me that increasingly it seems reducing the amount of black bodies that we see both taps us into a larger narrative of anti-black violence, if that's what we want to focus on. But more importantly, it gets us to how little we actually need to see of a black body to understand the possibility of personhood. Mm-hmm. Right. Which I feel like there's a richness in that, especially when so many institutions are invested in diversity and inclusion efforts, which require black and brown people to constantly make ourselves visible, mm-hmm. right? Or present the illusion of ongoing access over and over and over, which is a very polite form of institutional violence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This is one of my favorite pieces. And I make my son, I have a son who's gonna be 15 in December, and I make him view this because he appears to be older than he is. And I'm constantly reminding him growing up in Portland, we live in Southeast Portland, and he went to Sunnyside Environmental School and goes to Benson High School and all these things. And he loses within that environment sometimes what it means to be black. And I always remind him, like, Malik, there's things that your friends can do that you can't do, or there's ways that you'll get in trouble that your friends won't get in trouble. And he tries to dismiss it sometimes. And it's almost very emotional, because when I see this, I remind him, like, this could be you too. Like, you are public enemy number one, just being black, you know? Just being a black male in society. I know what it means to be a black queer woman, but I don't know the viciousness sometimes it is to be a black male. And this one, it chokes me up a bit, because I make Malik look at this and see this is something that happened so long ago, but it is still so relevant today. It was relevant for my parents. It was relevant before then, before, before, before. And it's still the same today. Mm-hmm. It's powerful. It's very powerful. And the cropping of it is, it can place anybody in it. It's a very powerful piece. Mm. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Hank? Back to you. You want to tell us a thing about this image? You're the expert.
Well, I was just listening. As many of us might recall, that you know our great and lauded Constitution, that some people think should never have been edited, counted some people, especially people who looked like us. Well, half of us weren't counted as people at all, and then some of us were counted as 3/5 of a human being when the Constitution was written. And I constantly refer back to things that I admire and I respect but with a critical lens, because I think in order to embrace them more fully, I have to kind of make them more personal. And I look at history that way. I think about there was a famous abolitionist pen made in England called that said, it was of a kneeling slave, and it says, "Am I not a man and a brother?" And I that always stuck with me. And I met another black photographer named Ernest Withers, who was in Memphis, Tennessee, a well-known and respected photographer there, civil rights photographer. And he took this iconic image of African-American sanitation workers who were protesting their segregated workplace. And they were holding signs of people saying, "I am a man." And it was in Memphis in support of their movement that Martin Luther King was assassinated. And there is, I always felt it was fascinating, because when I was 8 years before I was born, that it was necessary. When I made this piece in 2009, and it's also how fun any life changes, where you're like, this was crazy. I can't believe that they felt that they needed to affirm their humanity in America. That's during the Obama years, in early Obama years, I should say. And because the phrase I grew up with after segregation, during the integration period, wasn't "I am a man," it was "I am the man." Yeah. And I felt that there was something curious about how it went from being this collective statement under segregation to this seemingly selfish a statement post-integration. And then I like to read, so the top line, you know, I think as a timeline or references to history, and the bottom line I like to read as a poem, where it says, "I'm the man, who's the man, you the man, what a man, I am human, I am many, I am I. I am, I am, I am, amen." Because my grandmother used to always, you know, she continues to embed in me a level of faith and appreciation. And she helped me to realize that the greatest gift that I have and that any of us have is our consciousness. Mm-hmm. That all the other things that we can kind of use to define and describe ourselves fall short of just what it means to be aware that we are gifted by being awake. I don't know how to say more than that.
Yeah, yeah. If you, one of the things I'm having to contend with, like some Black Studies scholarship, right, is like thinking about the legacies of the Civil Rights Movement and the masculinist framings of the Civil Rights Movement. Right, it's like Erica Edwards has this great book called Charisma, and it's on fictions of Black leadership. And one of the things that she's pushing us to question is what it means for folks to hold on to what I would consider sometimes laughingly the strong, unwavering arm of the Black patriarch. Like, that's how we're going to move forward. And I'm like, so then I see this piece, I love this piece, I keep coming back to it because it's one of the pieces that brought me to your work. And I'm also trying to figure out, if a Black woman living during the Civil Rights Movement was the center of this particular piece, how would you change it?
Well, a Black woman organized that photograph.
Tell me more.
She organized that march. I mean, a lot of what happened in the Civil Rights Movement was that there were Black women and Black queer men who were like choosing the right people to fit the right role because of their appearance of respectability.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
so if it was women, they wouldn't have had the impact.
Absolutely.
You know, and if Martin Luther King wasn't, you know, a reverend and a son of a lauded person who was married to a person of another respectable family, they wouldn't have been able to have that power. And so a lot of it was branding, you know, and unfortunately, a lot of people having to sit back so that, you know, and putting people in place to, like, you know, make the statement that the rest of the country could buy into. And yeah, so there's a lot there that I, you know, and I'm learning this stuff, you know, and then we learned that Ernest Withers also was a FBI informant. Yeah, yeah. So the layers of the stories are deep, you know. And that's what all of my work is about. Is there's more things happening outside of the frame of the picture than there is inside of it.
Yeah.
And so in the one version of this picture, you can see her off to the left. Mm-hmm. But no one, and you know, so I don't even remember her name.
Okay, but. Got you. Danielle and Ragen. Mm-hmm. All right, so can y'all talk to us a bit about mediating images of Black people and stories that appear to be about Black life but are actually about white capitalism?
Well, no pressure. Danielle,
that's a great answer. Danielle has a great answer for that one.
But I'm gonna hear what you say first. repeat the question one more time.
So I'm interested as folks that are working in media, right? Mm-hmm. Like, how do you navigate that balance between like representing Black life and then representing or using Black bodies to represent the narratives of Black life that animate and propel white capitalism?
Right. I think like one important thing is questioning where our images are coming from in the first place. Like, who is orchestrating our images? And who do we contract for images that we want to use to depict Black life, Black people? And a start is making sure that we, you know, get in contact and pay Black photographers for their work, and especially work that they create that already you know, encapsulates Black life in an honest way. And so that's something we do. Mm-hmm. Ragen, anything to add?
I think in what I do in the lovely world of wardrobe styling, I think for my personal work, I think it's just always being true to my experience and telling the story of being Black and how I view it and applying it to that. Mm-hmm. Repeat the question.
Yeah. Well, it's really about, you know, how you reconcile essentially, right, institutionally, like, we as Black folks are in many ways supposed to represent the community,
right,
which is a very coded professional way of saying give us access to who you are. Mm-hmm. So on the one hand, there's that expectation that is seldom spoken, but absolutely it's a part of every,
sure,
conversation.
Oh, yeah.
How do you balance that reality with the presumption that, oh no, you're just helping us cultivate images of Black people that can help us make more money?
No, I know that from the jump. Yeah. Like, it's like, you need me, you are utilizing, and I've been in situations outside of, you know, in my career of people utilizing my ideas just to get the culture and the feeling. And I'll, mm-hmm, always advocate for myself of like, you want my vision, you want my culture, you want my feeling, you want the me. You can't have the me unless you can pay the me, you know? So I think that, and I've been in situations where, you know, I've lost jobs or other moments of like, oh no, you just took my voice. My father, he's a visual artist. He is always an inspiration, constant inspiration for my creative self. But he always reminds me, like, you have the ideas. You are the it. So they can take it from you, but they can never recreate it and continuously create it. So I hold fast to that. But I mean, this is what's been happening to us for centuries upon centuries upon centuries. Mm-hmm. But we always create and build it. This is what we did. We made nothing out of something, and we continuously, mm-hmm, do that. So you can try, but you, mm-hmm, can pay me for it. And if you can't, good luck trying to recreate it.
Yeah.
And how do you navigate that in academia?
Absolutely. They, you know, it's from the moment I had to write diversity statements for scholarships, and they want me to put my pain on a page. Right? Like, that's how I like paid my way. Not, that's how I use somebody else's money to get a degree. Like, and that's the thing, right? It's like, I realized I had a mentor help me understand that I don't need to cart out all of my hurt and my pain and my trauma. Mm-hmm. There are actually some really nice nuanced ways that I can perform the expectation to get whatever kind of access I want and need. Because the institution ain't gonna see me, the institution still don't see me.
I think it's also, you talked about how you navigate in the classroom
in really
explicit ways, though.
Mm-hmm. I'm like, I just, at this point, my grandpa says no romance without finance. And so I show up enough to like get my coin, but then once I'm in the classroom, it's like me and my students are sitting there just geeking out over ignorant ratchet shit. right? But that's like our work, is to be in that space, to process not just history, but theory, art, all of these things, and try to build a vocabulary. But, you know, none of what I do in a classroom, or none of what my students and I build in a classroom, will ever be a part of a contract, mm-hmm. right? Like, it'll never be a part of what an institutional thinks is possible through Black Studies, right? Or the centering of Black life. And so I'm like, I know that y'all are gonna evaluate me on XYZ. I'm gonna talk about XYZ. Y'all don't get to know shit else. I believe in invoices and lies. Mm-hmm. And this is like one of the ways that Black people have survived institutions. And so I'm like, I'm a lying, lying, lie, and make sure that the checks are clearing. And I'm also gonna try
you
to-
You know where this is being live streamed though.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's it. At this point, you know, I can like claim a radicality that is non-existent because people won't like
you have tenure.
Deeply enough. Yeah.
Some of that stuff is so real in the corporate space too, as a Black employee, right? There's a certain amount that I'm gonna give you as a Black employee, but beyond my pay grade and what I choose to share, I'm not giving you any more because you shouldn't be privy to that.
Mm-hmm. I find it to be the interesting thing. I worked with a visual artist. She's from here, and she lives in New York. Her name is Shauna X, and we constantly have conversations of, like, when it was talking about her being commissioned to do X, Y, and Z and negotiating contracts and going back for, like, oh, well, we can't do it for that much because, you know, but it's like, you want her culture, you want her voice, you want her opinion. And I always find it interesting because I believe if it's a white male who enters the room and says, no, I need this, this, this for this, people stop and they bow down and they're like, well, so-and-so needs this and he needs that along with it and a horse to ride on and do that whole thing and let's make space for it. So for myself, and it could get me in a lot of trouble, it has gotten me in a lot of trouble sometimes. There's this fight in me of like, no, fuck that. Sorry, I don't know if I can say that, but like, fuck that. Mm-hmm. You know, like, it's we a safe should. Space. I had suburban, God damn it. I feel like Beyonce. I'm here. I'm making it. Yes, it's me. No, but like, it is a sense of like, fuck that. Why can't we be honest with who we are? Because that's what you want. You want the honesty. This is me. You know, this is my Blackness. This is me. This is the reads. This is the realness. This is all of it. So you can't take part of it. You have to take it all. And I in my heart, maybe this is why I'm not rich, but I in my heart feel like I can't curb that for you. I don't want to curb that for you. This is me. This is my honest opinion. And at the end of the day, this is what you want.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Damn. Oh, sounds wrong. Like you know. Oh, you know.
Box water.
All right, Hank, you referenced this piece earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit more about it. We're back to torsos.
Well, people used to think that was my body, and I would lie and say yes.
You can lie. You can lie.
Yes, my friend Adrian. Again, a lot of the way I make work is by accident in a lot of ways. I didn't know what I was going for and looking for when I asked him to pose for this. And I didn't even think of what I was making was art. You know, I was really just trying to understand. There's a famous photograph of a former slave named Gordon, a Black slave who was, you know, whipped so brutally that you could see the keloids on his back. And that image was in my mind when I started to think about making this, but then also his body is just so beautiful that I was like, I don't know, there's something seductive about it in a way that I don't know how to talk about, which also made me feel uncomfortable, not only in the making it, but also in the presentation of it, because a lot, you know, the best thing you can do for any corporation is to use their brand, and one of the beauties of what Nike has done is like, oh, you want to bootleg our brand? Great, go ahead, because that means more people know this brand and understand this language. But also, and I think sometimes people think of my work that I am anti-corporate, but I don't think that you can, I really see myself as trying to critique the systems that I already participate in. But also thinking, it forced me to look at his body and think about scarification and how I was trained to think of it as gross and disgusting. And then start to think about, see the beauty in it. And I think that is another kind of layer of the work that the symbols that were created, that people, you know, we talk about art as something separate from our lives in Western culture, but in many other cultures, like, there is no, art is life. Our bodies are art, you know. Not only what we adorn, the way we mark our bodies, the way we talk, the way we dance, the way we wear our hair is art. It's not supposed to be up on the wall. It is life. And I think that's something that's kind of layered in this work that I don't really get to speak about often.
So y'all, Nike, I'm wondering if y'all could talk about what labor does for the creation of images of Black bodies. Right, so in this context, we can consider like a Black sporting body. We can consider what labor does to the production of an image of Black bodies that helps sell athletic apparel. What kinds of discussions of labor are y'all having about sweatshop labor? Like, is that ever entering the room when y'all are thinking about how bodies are assembled to communicate a particular message, or how you think about the ethical implications of a company's labor practices? Like, is that ever in the room when y'all are sculpting an image for circulation?
I can say as a consumer, is it in the room constantly, but that comes from consumerism and us people needing it cheap, fast, and now. So I guess as a consumer, I always ask myself about those things, what I'm buying, is it ethical? Is it is it sustainable? But that, I think, comes to us in our deep fascination and joy in consumerism and getting something now fast and quick. I don't know, that's what I can speak to it. I also don't work for Nike.
And same here too,
Tell me the thing.
No, and funnily enough, like, Nike's one of the few brands that we have that I've never worked on. So I can't really speak in that jurisdiction. I wouldn't feel comfortable doing that. But I can only speak as a consumer as well. And being from a place which is not originally the US, where it's a third world country, and you end up kind of getting for lack of a better word, the secondhand garbage, less valuable stuff. And there is a desire that's created from the advertising you see to want that stuff. And so for a lot of people growing up where I did, you don't think twice to consider the labor in another third world country that went into making the apparel that is being so widely commodified. And for a long time, I didn't either. Not until, quite frankly, I came to the US and was made aware of situations like you mentioned. And so, yeah, I can only speak as a consumer now, and as far as like making ethical decisions about what I wear, what I choose to buy, and that type of stuff.
Cool, dig it. How y'all holding up?
Cool. Great, cool. I'm gonna take some more of this.
Yeah, though. Go ahead, yeah. Hey, stay warm, stay sharp.
Yeah.
All right, so Hank.
Sorry.
No, you're good.
I have a 15-year-old.
So Hank, I'm not an art historian. I'm not an art critic proper. I don't know how to talk in very astute academic critical ways about what's happening with this piece. I just thoroughly enjoy it. And so I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about this piece.
Well, why do you enjoy it?
It's like flashes. I like scenes, vignettes. I like these kind of minor moments that make me want to jump deeper into something. And so I keep wanting to jump deeper into different aspects of this piece. And so I like that. It feels like a particular kind of invitation that I don't really have a language for. But it makes me want a language.
Well, for me, there's a couple things I notice immediately when I look at it. It was made in 2013, and Raise Up was made in 2014. This is a picture of a baptism taken in Washington, D.C. by, I believe, a photographer named Addison Scurlock. For me, looking at this image and thinking about this idea of people wading through the water to get salvation, but also thinking about escaping to slavery, escaping across the Ohio River to get emancipated. That there's a lot there for me, but also what the triangles mean. These are flag frames that are used normally for the memorials of when a fallen American soldier dies. They often present the family with a flag that's wrapped in a triangle with all the stars visible. Mm-hmm. And that's what these are. And then, but then there's a pattern in the middle that looks like a bow tie. And this references the African-American quilting tradition and a lot of the patterns that were used during slavery. And it's believed that there are codes often in the quilts that people would put out on their lines to help people who were escaping north to know what a safe house was on the Underground Railroad, et cetera. And so, for me, this piece is layered with so many different things. I also have always been like, is this really gonna stay together? Because it hangs on the wall perfectly, but the carpenter I worked with to build it was just like, you know, this is impossible, right? And now it's, you know, it's been, and that's also what I'm always interested in my work, is I often work with people who are experts in one thing to do something they've never done before.
Yeah.
And also what it means to look at a photograph that's kind of broken apart in all of these different ways, and so you have to complete it in your mind. Hmm.
No, that's what's up. I'm like looking at it again, just like I can see a version on the screen back here, and all I can see is rewind and fast forward buttons.
Right.
At one point when I first started getting tatted, I was like fixated. I was like, self, you're gonna get all tattoos that relate to audio technology. Like fast forward, rewind, the whole nine. But like I kept thinking about that, and now also thinking about Scurlock Studios, that archive is so rich. Right, it's just like black people showing up in these studios, and even at times like having some external shots of just black life in Washington, D.C. and Maryland, like it was so beautiful and so rich. And the number of photographers in the early to mid 20th century, black photographers that were paying attention to baptisms. My friend Bart has read enough in black theology to be able to talk critically about that.
Hello, Bart.
Hey, boo. I have not, but it's just something that resonates with me, like this ongoing documentation of black spiritual practices and hands being raised and also bodily submission. All of that kind of stuff comes up for me. Let's go here to this place.
Mm-hmm.
Branded.
Yeah.
What's come about?
So this is a piece that was... it's called Priceless. It was taken at my cousin's funeral. My cousin Sangha Thomas Willis was murdered in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania on February 2nd, 2000. And it was one of, there definitely was a before and after for me in that event, because we were roommates and best friends, and he was basically my like life plan. I was just like, I'm just gonna be your backup singer in life. And I was raised to be his backup singer. Like everyone's like, you don't really matter, he's the one that matters. And I think he was less comfortable with that dynamic than I was, but he was good at everything and I was not. And so everything I, losing him forced me to be like, you know, become a man, so to speak, and become a person who had had some own self-direction in a lot of ways. And so, that loss molded me in many ways, and you know, cynically, if he were alive, he would say, "I did it on purpose," you know, because he there was this kind of tension of what it meant to be like. He was good at sports. He went to like these boarding schools, and he was in this committee, and you know, all these things that like, and he looked the way, and what it meant to be the black boy who people had hope for, and how limiting that was, you know, for like, oh, you can't do this because you're the one who has that hope. We have all that hope. And then for him to have died kind of on a, what seemed to be on a whim, where he was in Philly visiting my grandmother and saw some friends from junior high school. They took him out to like show him a good time, but they were wearing like these gold and diamond chains and got robbed. And the guys who saw, some guys saw him with my cousin, saw my cousin with them. They made him lay face down in the snow and shot him in the back of the head. The other guys just lost their necklaces. Mm-hmm. And the boys who killed him got away with murder that night. And it was so, I feel ambivalent because it's so sad that they're, because they say that what the murderer always returns to the scene of the crime. So they returned to the scene of the crime 2 months later. and another night they started with one of them saying, I want to go get a chain. Mm-hmm. And they again, you know, took the chain off this kid and they were shooting in a crowd and killed someone else. But that mm-hmm. time the police were watching because they knew that there had been some violence there before. Mm-hmm. And I guess in the morning of, in the process, my cousin being 27 years old and realizing all these weird things that kind of go into, you know, the performance of a funeral, of a life that meant something, is that you have to buy him a new suit and new shoes. And, you know, the ultimate decision to watch my aunt and my mother make was the picking of the casket. You know, it's like this, there's an unspoken thing that says that you love him more if you buy like the $7,000 box of wood that's going to be thrown in the dirt, never to be seen again. Maybe if you buy the $2,000 one that, you know, mm-hmm. you couldn't afford to love him enough.
Right.
And then there's the headstone. And either way, with my family, it was going to have to go on a credit card. Mm-hmm. So it was this impossible decision to watch them make. And, you know, a lot of the, and I realized again that advertising is the most ubiquitous language in the world. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't have to speak or read the language, mm-hmm. like, to understand the ad. Yeah. That's, and it's because we've been trained to, like, see certain cues and get a feeling. And I feel like, how do we talk about the value of one life and what a family might go through? Mm-hmm. And the best way I felt like to reach a broader audience was through kind of using advertising to tell that story, because advertising also is a language that is so powerful, but it's only used to sell. Like, the beauty of advertising is the talent behind it. The products almost have nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. And so I really feel that it's important for many of us to start using that language to tell, you know, other stories. And so this is my aunt, who will be here tomorrow, and my uncle Michael on the left. And it was really also challenging to, like, ask them to participate in it, but they also saw the value of my work and encouraged me to do it.
Dan, thank you for that. Thank
you.
Low-key, we don't deserve that kind of access. And so I want to acknowledge that you're like,
that's why I make
things.
The work.
So yeah, no, that's
a part of all of us.
So well, I don't have critical things to say, you know, I'm just, it's this piece, Danielle.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the thing about gun violence is it affects all of us, mm-hmm. you know, and also we all love guns and violence because that's, you turn on the television, that's what we fantasize about. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think you have to be directly affected by it to necessarily feel like you can or should be part of the conversation. Mm-hmm. So I am, and you know, and it's, and I, yeah, it's so, it is super challenging, yeah. You know.
Danielle and Ragen, how do y'all navigate? A lot of stuff is like, how do y'all navigate? Because I'm hella nosy. I want to know, like, what y'all can and can't tell us from inside Wieden Kennedy.
Start with a can't.
Right? Like, I want all the can't. Take us to the limits, right? Like, I don't want y'all getting, like, a strongly worded email tomorrow. But, like, what can you tell us about the extent to which these kind of conversations show up in, like, boardrooms, show up in meetings? Because for me, anyway, when I'm thinking about contemporary popular media, like, there is this narrative of protection of particularly young Black men who are our promise, right? Like, families have people who they invest time, energy, the whole nine into. And there's also, like, members in the family who it's like, we need to be extra vigilant in terms of creating more limits for them. So I'm wondering about the extent to which those conversations show up in y'all's professional lives. Because part of that, right, is like, you can't spill too much tea on your family, but also it's, well, we're selling this idea of who Black people might be, mm-hmm. and this could be perpetuating one narrative that I don't want to show up for, but y'all are also signing my checks.
Yeah. So, there's one instance that comes to mind immediately, and I forget what year it was exactly. The Wieden folks in the crowd can, like, shout it or remind me, but it was the year Alton Sterling and Philando Castile, that back-to-back killing happened. Just to preface that, I pull from my experience as an Afro-Caribbean woman living in Portland and having not grown up as a Black kid in the U.S., right? There's this learning to navigate Blackness that I'm still learning to do in this country, right? And so that double killing in particular, I had maybe been a year in at Portland, and kind of really realizing that, oh shoot, in this city, in this country especially, as opposed to home where I identify so much by my nationality and other Caribbean people do as well, I'm just Black here. Like nobody is like asking me, you know, like, so like, what kind of Black are you? It's just like, you're just Black, right? Mm-hmm. And so that killing happened and it tore me up. And obviously tore up a lot of other Black folks at Wieden and you know, wider. And a coworker of ours, he was so pissed off, like many of us were, that we kind of, like that happened and we still had to go through the day to day, like going to meetings and acting like nothing happened and no white person really said anything. Like, I mean, not that you expect them to, but in those moments, it's like, do you see my humanity here? And do you see why it's not okay that we are just going along the everyday? And so he sent an email basically saying like, why your Black coworker is silent today, extra silent today, or is extra moody today, or what have you. And it took him to say something to the wider agency to start a conversation about what happened and what our collective response as Black people were to it, and what white people's response was to it as well, and then our collective response as an agency. And that, you know, it sucks that it took that to jumpstart that conversation and to really initiate that conversation within the agency. But it was a really powerful moment because it forced us all to confront what the reality and symptoms of that whole situation were. And so yeah, like since then those conversations happen pretty frequently and they're messy and people get upset. And I had to take 2 days off. I couldn't deal. And I think in that moment, had we not had that conversation, I don't know how empathetic the higher ups would have been about like letting some of us like maybe take a mental health day or, you know, and I might be making some people upset by saying some of this stuff, but yeah, like those, since then those conversations happen, I think a lot more than they typically do elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. As you're talking, I'm thinking about the fact that like, there's this piece that I teach, and I'm completely blanking on the writer's name, Muhammad, on innocence. Jackie Wayne, thank you, good looking out. So I was teaching this piece, Muhammad, like there was this great moment in class where we're talking through it, and it's about the construction of innocent Black subjects. And Muhammad was like, oh, hey, correct me if I'm misquoting you, okay? Muhammad was like, oh, so in an anti-Black context, a Black person has to die before they can be innocent. Mm. Right, was like sharpest damn reading of that piece, right? So it then makes me wonder about the role that anti-Black violence plays in the production of white progress, right? Like it's a precondition for the narrative of white progress. And so that, you know, kind of gets me thinking, Hank, more about this particular piece and what it means for your work to memorialize these really intimate moments in Black life, such that we can think specifically about the family, right? About your family, but also we can have these broad, not even broader, we can have these other kinds of conversations about structural oppression. Right? So it depends on who the focus is. This piece can both be evidence of particular modes of destruction, right? And the ongoing erosion of Black life prematurely, like Alicidia Hartman. But it can also be like, what the fuck does Black grief look like? And what are all the layers that go into the production of a moment in Black grief? Right? Like all of that stuff is there. So again, like, thank you for that access to this particular piece. You also maybe briefly on, go ahead.
No, I just want to say again, I feel like it's important as a mom of a teenage boy, I'm like, this is my, I think about this every day for my son, you know, like, are you riding the bus? Okay, cool. Did you make it here? Did you do this? Are you okay? Text me when you get here. It's like this whole thing, because I think about this, and when you talk about like how we navigate our lives of like, this person is going to make it, or this is the one, you mm-hmm. know? I look at that, like, to ask myself, like, is Malik going to make it till he's 21? Will he?
Yeah, we used to make jokes, oh, black grown over 21.
Right.
Like, okay. That yeah. was like, that was funny.
I have friends who are like, oh, I made it till I was this and didn't go to jail or didn't do this. And I'm like, Malik, are you going to be wrongfully accused for X, Y, and Z? Like, this is, it's a haunting every day. Yeah. It's a haunting every day. And mm-hmm. when I look at this picture, I just, you know, I hope to God, like, it's not. And I do everything to align or try to align that it's not. Yeah. But it's a real reality. It's a real reality that you have to live through and you have to navigate through.
Yeah.
I don't know, I just get lost in it thinking about that. But yeah, it's real. It's very real. It's still real. Yeah.
All right, so y'all, we've got a little bit of time for Q&A. Ella, about how many minutes we got for Q&A?
About like 10.
Okay, cool. Oh, that's perfect. Bless you. All right, so y'all, first, thank y'all for like chatting it up. Really appreciate it. Okay, so y'all, we've got a booming 10 minutes for Q&A. Please, please give us concise, straightforward questions drafted on your phone. If you have more of a comment than a question, draft it on your phone, turn it into a succinct question, and then just lob it on forward. Okay.
Ella and I have mics on either side of the room to run for Q&A.
I don't know. Oh, it's on. Sorry. Okay.
There's some behind you, Ella.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey.
My name is Brian. I work at Cinco Design over in Southeast.
Cool.
Cheers. Represent. I sit here, I'm wearing Jordans, and I love the infusion of art into Hank's work. This isn't just a question for Hank, but I was curious, like, do you feel like someone like Michael Jordan as like the legend that he is, do you feel like all these brands somewhat like took advantage of him in sport? And then also a second question sort of tied to that is the recent law that was passed in California to pay college students for endorsements and whatnot, and just how that all relates to this bigger picture.
Cool. Yeah, does anybody else? I have things to say, but I don't know. I mean, we are all constantly taking advantage of each other all the time, and I don't think anybody who has close to $1 billion can be that upset about how he might have been exploited. But also, it's because, frankly, some of Michael Jordan's inaction. He was famous for when they asked him to support an African American candidate in North Carolina, where he was who's running for Senate against Jesse Helms, a notoriously racist senator. Harvey Gantt was running against him, and they asked Michael Jordan to endorse Harvey Gantt. He's like, Republicans buy shoes too, was his answer, which was seen as a sellout perspective. He was so loyal to his brand that when Reebok sponsored the Olympic team in 1992, that he covered the Reebok jersey logo on his jersey with an American flag because he had to keep his message so tight. But 20 years after he started, you know, first of all, it was a different America, a different world, because of the doors he opened by his participation in this kind of good Negro, not troublemaker perspective. You know, there are people like LeBron James who have incredible access and opportunity that's completely built upon his shoulders. And LeBron, recognizing that he was able to kind of make the game his own in a lot of ways because of previous generations, recognizes that it's his responsibility to do that for others. And he didn't have to go to college, you know, and he recognized how many of his peers were exploited in very explicit ways through the NCAA, and that he now, as a LA Laker in a state like California, can have a greater impact, because Nike's not going anywhere. NCAA has nothing on him. And now I believe college athletes who have been, you know, it's a billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar industry fueled off of primarily the free laborers or the descendants of slaves. And so the piece Cotton Bowl that's in the other room, where there's a person wearing an Ole Miss uniform standing across from a cotton picker, is really about that kind of complexity. You know, that it's many times it's they're playing on the same fields that their ancestors worked on. So anyway, so I don't know. I think and that symbol is so triumphant. You know, I've seen pictures of a KKK rally where people wearing Jordan logo. And I'm like, this is interesting, because your message is not as strong as it might have been.
So what's up? Yeah, another question?
I have a question over here.
All right, dig it.
Mr. Thomas, I noted in your selection of films in San Francisco, you included Black Is, Black Ain't. Does Marlon Riggs have influence on your work?
Yeah. Did you want to give some context for who Marlon Riggs is?
No, you go right ahead.
Well, Marlon Riggs is an incredible filmmaker who passed away in the late 80s from AIDS. And he, in many ways, revolutionized the way in which people use spoke about their identity through film, by personalizing it, by critiquing the way in which black masculinity, especially black heteronormative masculinity, was kind of seen through media and popular culture. And this idea of Black Is, Black Ain't, is that, because race is a fiction, I don't believe in race. It's a game that's being played on all of us. Like, these kind of people were born this way and they have these kind of virtues, or these kind of people were born this way and they have these kinds of problems. It is only real because we've been taught to make it real. And as soon as someone is labeled as black, that means they are inherently less valuable of a person. So when they say on the news, a young black man was killed, that's to tell you, it wasn't a person. It was a person like this, you know, so we couldn't cry over Tamir Rice being a boy playing in his yard who was killed by the police. It was racialized, which made it about teams. Mm-hmm. And so for me, Black Is, like Black Ain't is the beginning of a lot of that thinking for me, of recognizing how people find freedom through the navigation of this maze. But also because while I say I don't believe in race, I also firmly believe that there's no stronger power in the universe than black joy, because it has been tested and never been destroyed. And that is kind of something that I really try to like wrestle with in my work, and that like, that's why people want what you have, is because it's like, wait, but how? I mean, everything has been, like, we've been trying to destroy your spirit from the moment you were born, and you still can be happy? You know, and that's something that I think I try to highlight in my work in certain ways. And there's a piece called A Person Is More Important Than Anything Else. It's a 5-channel video installation that features the words of James Baldwin from 50 years ago and the context of today. Yeah. I got long answers. I'm sorry.
No, this is great. Okay, we got time for one more right here.
I wanted to know, did the history of this state and you bringing this work, being very in your face with blackness and race, and what came through your mind about bringing this to Portland, being the star of the white utopia of Oregon? And how do you, now I'm going A, B, and C, sorry. Did that go through your mind? Two, how did you internalize that? And three, just thinking about looking at this room, thankfully we were given to be your center of focus when you looked into this crowd, but yet look at the number of white faces here. Mm-hmm. And this is our reality, being people that live here, is that as long as we are entertaining or artistic, then we can be at the forefront. Yet if we are not, then we need to get out of the way. because it's not for us.
Well, I will say the idea of a Oregon as a white haven is something that I really hope I get invited back to talk about in my work. But again, I don't believe in race. You know, I don't believe, I don't want to give anyone else this power to tell me that I can look at someone else and assume anything about them by looking at their skin. And so I see it like the Matrix, like Batman, like or movies. When I watch Batman, I know he has superpowers. And so when I talk about race and recognize, you know, white supremacy is an invisible force that shapes a lot of my life, I also recognize that part of it is for me to have animosity around people who I am presumed to believe is white, but also that we live in a society where, you know, we talk about blackness and whiteness, but Muhammad, I don't think you identify as either. No, you don't, right? And most of the world doesn't. This is just an American joke. You know, when you go to Senegal, you go to Cambodia, you go to China, where, you know, it's almost a third of the population are Chinese alone. And India, you know, we've now exported our own problem of white supremacy into other societies through our cultural hegemony. And a lot of what I'm trying to struggle with is, like, knowing that my ideas won't save me, you know, as a black man in the society, but also that my anger won't either. The only thing that I believe could ever save me is my love for other people and my ability to see beyond all of the things I've been trained to hate, including myself. However, but I don't live here, so I can't say.
All right, y'all, on that note, thank y'all again. Y'all are dope. It's a good time. And I still got a little bit of bourbon left if y'all are thirsty.
After her question, I'll tell
you. So we're going to check out some art. Ella, how do you want to do this?
Yeah, thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you for those questions. A round of applause for the panelists. Thank you. We can now go over to the galleries. Please enjoy. We're interested in feedback as well. Thank you so much. Okay, that's it. Let's go.